Earnings call. First of all, best wishes for you and your families' health and safety. Last few months have been very difficult for all of us, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank all our stakeholders for their continued support. In recent times, we have announced a slew of measures to support our employees, including tie-ups with leading hospitals, extending insurance coverage, and financial assistance to families in case of any mishap, etc. We are closely monitoring the situation, and we remain extremely focused on ensuring the well-being of all our employees, our dealers, our suppliers, and all our stakeholders. Moving on to business, positive demand momentum continued in India in quarter four, resulting in the strongest quarter in terms of revenue. In Europe, we saw demand recovery in the fourth quarter. In both geographies, we gained market share in key product categories. Coming to Q4 financial performance, I am extremely pleased with a healthy operating performance in India and an extremely strong and steadily increasing operating margins in Europe. This was achieved despite rising raw material pressure. We are leveraging new age technologies to increase engagement level with our stakeholders, re-engineer, optimize processes, and reduce costs on a long-term sustainable basis. In Europe, despite uncertain economic environment, we have successfully executed the Enschede plant specialization, which in turn helped us significantly improve operating performance of our European operations. Despite the second wave of COVID-19 hitting us hard, we remain focused on converting the current crisis into an opportunity and emerge from this as a leaner, much more efficient, and much more effective company. Over the last 1 year, efforts on various fronts have ensured that we have emerged stronger through this pandemic crisis and are much better placed than last year to face the ongoing challenge. I'm happy to report that despite the COVID-19 crisis, we've been able to significantly strengthen our balance sheet, both in terms of solvency and liquidity. Our net debt EBITDA for the consolidated operations stood at 1.5 times as on 31st March 2021, as compared to 3.2 times as on 31st March last year. Going forward, the focus would continue to be on controlled capital allocation, sweating off our assets, and keeping the balance sheet leverage at reasonable levels. Finally, in terms of outlook, while we have limited ability to forecast near-term demand trends given the multiple COVID-19 outbreaks and its impact on business, I would use this opportunity to reiterate our focus areas. First, we are committed to use this opportunity to emerge as a leaner and a more efficient organization. Second, we continue to see huge opportunity in our key markets over medium and long term, and are well placed to leverage the same given our investments in the capacity, in R&D, in brand building, in our distribution, and our cost optimization. I'm deeply pained by the adverse impact of COVID-19 on all our employees and their families, and would prioritize safety, health, and well-being of my fellow employees above everything else. With this, I will conclude my opening remarks, and I'd like to hand over to Gaurav, our CFO. Please stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you, Neeraj. And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Continuing from where Neeraj left, again, I would like to iterate that as a company, we are focused first and foremost on the safety and well-being of our employees and the relevant stakeholders. In India, all of us are facing the unprecedented challenge dealing with this pandemic. The uncertainty around business is back almost around the same situation as last year. However, given the various strategic measures taken through last year in both the India and the Europe operations, we are far better placed and in a stronger financial position to face the current situation. To just list some of these measures, The AP Greenfield was successfully commissioned and is ramping up. We have had market share gains across segments in India. We've increased our distribution network in India, Europe, and some of the other geographies. A successful execution of the specialization of the Dutch plant, leading to improved cost competitiveness in Europe and already being visible in the improved margins. Continuing to improve our product mix in the passenger car tire segment in Europe. Sweating of the assets leading to a significant improvement in our return on capital employed and the leveraging levels now at healthy levels. Moving on to the financial results, the consolidated revenue for the quarter stood at rupees 50.3 billion, a growth of 39% over the same quarter last year. This was contributed by a big growth from the Indian operations, but all the operations registered growth vis-a-vis the same quarter last year. The consolidated EBITDA for the quarter stood at rupees 8.1 billion, a margin of 16% compared to a 13% plus in the same period last year. This was helped by the significant growth in top line, a continued control over costs, and the European operations showing the signs of significantly improved profitability on the back of the Dutch plant specialization. We have already mentioned our strengthening of the balance sheet. The net debt decreased from rupees 60 billion in March 20 to rupees 43 billion 1 year down the line, with the net debt EBITDA being at 1.5 times. Moving on to India operations, the revenue for the quarter was rupees 36.3 billion, a growth of 49% over the same period last year, and 6% even on a sequential basis. This was a record high for the Indian operations and coming on the back of a record high in the previous December quarter. The Indian operations have delivered two consecutive quarters of record all-time high revenues. On a full year basis also, the India operations delivered a growth of 5% over previous year, in spite of running at negative growth through the year till the end of last quarter. The plants were operating at near full capacity, ensuring optimal sweating of assets. The top line growth for the quarter was driven by volume growth in all the channels, OEM, replacement, and exports. And in terms of product segments, all segments posted strong growth. However, given the impact of Q1, the overall industry still ended up with negative growth across product segments except the farm category, in spite of the strong recovery in the second half of the year. Based on our internal estimates, we have had market share gains across all segments, which shows our strong competitive position across categories. For the Indian operations, the EBITDA for the quarter stood at rupees 5.6 billion, a margin of 15.4% as compared to a 14.4% for the same period last year. The margin in the preceding quarter were upwards of 21%. The margins were maintained at these levels in spite of a very severe cost push on account of raw material of as much as 12%. Price increases have been taken in Q3 and Q4, but more is needed. One point to highlight, if we take out the impact of a one-time higher SIPCOT other operating income, the fall in EBITDA margin was about 370 basis points. The net debt for the Indian operations decreased from rupees 48 billion in March 20 to rupees 36 billion in March 21, again indicating a strong and a healthy balance sheet. In terms of outlook, we have seen a moderation in demand post mid-April. And while any one of us would have a limited ability to forecast near-term demand given the pandemic crisis, our discussion with various market participants indicate that May is likely to be the most impacted month, and thereafter the demand environment is expected to improve. We expect the demand to revive strongly like last year once the current wave is over, and over midterm the demand outlook remains strong. The raw material cost pressures would continue. The operations on the whole are geared up to take advantage of the demand and our strengthened competitive positioning. Moving on to Europe, revenues for the quarter were 135 million euro, up 8% compared to the same period last year. This growth was supported by an overall demand recovery and also market share gains in the UHP passenger car tire segment and TBR segment. The EBITDA for the quarter stood at euro 24 million, a very healthy 18% plus, a significant recovery from the margins that we were reporting just a short time back. The margin recovery has been supported by improvement in sales mix. Our UHP proportion for the year has increased to 36%. Cost containment measures and successful execution of the Dutch plant specialization. Even in Europe, we were able to maintain a very healthy liquidity situation on back of measures like reduction in capex, improvement in collections from customers, and efficient working capital management. The liquidity position was maintained in spite of funding the cost of specialization, the social plan package that had to be paid to approximately 500 colleagues who left the Dutch operations in this quarter in excess of 50 million euro. The outlook for the Europe operations is positive. Europe economy is showing signs of recovery and we expect growth to come back. The improved cost competitiveness position will help us drive margins to these healthy levels. Thank you, and we would be happy to take your questions.
Thank you, sir, for your opening remarks. We will now move on to the question and answer session. I would like to request the participants to use the raise your hand option to ask your question. Given the time constraint, I would request the participants to limit your questions to two per participant. The first question is from Mr. Raghunandan. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thank you very much for the opportunity, and I hope everyone at Apollo family are safe. Two questions. Firstly, congratulations on strong Europe performance. In Euro terms, Q4 Europe revenue is almost similar to Q2 revenues, but EBIT margin has increased by a significant 600 bips. So there is improvement in RM, employee cost, other expenses. Can you please elaborate and whether this is sustainable going forward? And also this the benefit of 500 employees leaving, since when will that start to reflect in numbers? That's my first question.
Okay, I'll try and answer this, and Gaurav, you come in also. So yes, the profit margins that you have seen in quarter four are sustainable going forward. That was one of the main reasons of doing the specialization in Europe. I want to also mention here is that we are now looking at selling more the ultra high performance and the UUHP sizes. Previously, we were at mid-30s as a percentage to the entire basket, which has gone up to now 37-38%. These are higher profit margin products which are going into the market. Market share has also gone up in this category to around 2.7% market share, which has gone up in Europe. So our focus going forward is going to be in this category also, trying to see how we can garner market share in the ultra high performance. Your second point, already the benefits have started coming in slowly because the people that have been removed have been gone since February and a little bit in March. You'll see the major input, the major benefit coming in this financial year. Gaurav, you want to add to that?
Just Raghunandan, yes. The entire restructuring specialization has been completed. You've seen a large part of that benefit coming in the current quarter. We will now see that benefit flowing through for the full year.
Thank you. Thank you for that. My second question is on the commodity prices. There has been a significant uptick. And if you can share the commodity basket, which you normally share, and also indicate what is the expectation for Q1 in terms of RM cost increase, and is the company in a position to take price hikes? I think even recently, competitors like MRF have, last week, taken about 2-2.5% price hikes. How much more price hikes are required, and what is the plan there? Thank you.
Yeah. So, Raghunandan, just to talk about the overall basket on the raw material, as I mentioned, moved up by almost 12% sequentially. Natural rubber was at 140 rupees a kg, synthetic rubber at 135, carbon black at 75. Going forward, we expect this pressure to continue. Even for Q1, sequentially, we expect the raw material prices to be up by close to high single digits vis-a-vis this quarter that we are talking about. Yes, MRF has finally taken the price increase and it's effective today. So that will provide us the ability to now start thinking of the next price increase. We've done two lots in Q3 and Q4, one each in each quarter, and we will start thinking about the next price increase.
Thank you, Gaurav. Thank you so much. I'll come back in the queue.
Thank you, Raghu.
Next question is from Mr. Nishilan. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello. Yeah. Hi, sir. Thank you for taking the question and congratulations on the set of performance. My first question is on Europe. How are we looking at pricing scenario in Europe? Because cost pressures will impact margins in Europe as well. Are we seeing companies taking pricing increases over there? And another question on Europe is basically after this restructuring exercise and reduction of capacity in Netherlands plant, what is the peak revenue potential that we can do in Europe with existing capacities in Hungary and Netherlands? Thank you.
Gaurav, did you understand that question?
First question was on the pricing, if I got Nishit right, in Europe. And the second was on the peak revenue potential for Europe post this specialization.
Yes. You want to answer the two, Gaurav?
Yeah. So, Nishit, in Europe, people are beginning to take price increases. The raw material escalation is hitting Europe operations only from the current quarter. Even in Q4 or the January to March quarter, our Europe operations, and I would suspect similarly the other peers, did not face the cost escalation on account of a much larger dependence on synthetic rubber and also a strong euro. So the cost pressures on account of raw material are now beginning to come into the June quarter. We've not had across the board price increases. People are taking selective price increases, but also with market recovery, it is coming through. We ourselves have announced price increases in select categories of mid-single digit. So we are dealing with the situation. To your second question on the maximum revenue potential, with this specialization and a very different sourcing perspective, a large part of European operations, especially on the passenger car, would be sourced from the Indian operations. So in terms of saying what is the capacity or revenue potential from the capacity in Europe itself would not be the right metric. Over a 5-year time frame, we are looking at revenue in the order of 750 to 800 million euro for our European operations.
Got it, Gaurav. Thank you so much. Just one follow-up on this. We have done about 135 million euro revenues in Europe in this quarter. So at these revenue run rate, what was the capacity utilization which the Hungary and Netherlands plants are operating at? Just wanted to get a sense of how much we will need to import from India and how much we can cater demand locally.
Sure. So at the current levels, the Hungary plant was operating at about 75% Nishit. The Dutch plant, based on the reduced capacity and specialization, was operating close to peak capacity.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
The next question is from Mr. Siddharth Dera. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, sir. Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congrats for a great set of results. So for my first question, again, is on Europe. So on the margin side, can you highlight if there was any COVID-related benefit in the quarter, anything of that sort in the quarter results?
Hello?
Yeah. Siddharth, no, there was no COVID-related benefit, etc. All of those were in the previous quarters announced by the various governments, and we got some part in Netherlands and in Hungary. In the current quarter, there was no COVID-related.
Okay, understood. And second is on the India margin side again. In your presentation, you have talked about a lot of things you are doing to bring down your cost on the commodity side by focusing on various recipes. Also, you have talked about some fixed cost reduction initiatives you are taking. So, but just wanted to check, first, for the quarter, what I see is that the commodity cost for you has been lower than what others have reported. And second is, how much of some of these initiatives can we expect to bring in more benefit on the commodity side, if possible, going ahead?
It's an ongoing dynamic situation, which the company is already investing a lot in R&D. We try and see how we can further reduce the weights of our tire. Also, collaborative effort with universities and with suppliers of raw material. Try and see how we can come up with new formulas which could be cheaper and which could be better in performance. This is an ongoing activity. Part of it is sustainable and part more things will happen as we go along. And this is the basic vision of the company, is to try and see how we have to come up over this commodity prices increase and try and reduce our raw material input cost coming into the tire. It's an ongoing kind of work that is happening in the organization. Whatever, you want to add anything there?
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So last thing is, if you can highlight the standalone gross debt and net debt levels and a sustainable tax rate, what we should assume for the business going ahead. Thanks, sir.
Gaurav?
Yeah. So the gross debt, Siddharth, was rupees 50 billion and the net debt was rupees 36 billion, as I mentioned earlier. Ravi, you would like to talk on the tax question?
If I can just get a question again. Sorry, I missed the last part. There's some network glitches.
I just wanted to check what should be a sustainable tax rate which we should assume going ahead for the India and Europe business for 22.
So, Siddharth, the ETR currently is around 31% for the India business and around 25% for the Europe business. And this will probably be the ETR for the coming financial years. For India, we are also monitoring the reduced rate of tax, which has been announced by the government a year back. And at the moment, we are in a beneficial position to continue with the current tax system.
Understood. Okay. Thanks, sir.
The next question is from Mr. Rahul Sharma. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi. Good afternoon, everyone. So I just wanted to check on, the raw material side. So what we are seeing globally is that especially the American manufacturer are running out of raw material to manufacture tire. So are we facing anything like that? Because people are saying, or the news articles are mentioning, that the China is cornering the raw material market. So are we facing such issues on sourcing of raw material?
No, so Rahul, there is a challenge on availability of raw material. But because of our good relationships with all our raw material suppliers, today I can say that we are holding inventory. We are, obviously it's a challenge, but we are not seeing any loss of production because of raw material supplies.
Okay. And on the price hike side, the current margin of 15-16% that we have, so what kind of hike would we need to take to maintain that kind of margin? Or apart from price hike, are we doing something on the fixed cost side that we that can be done on sustainable basis to maintain that kind of margin?
Well, you know, like I mentioned to you in my opening remarks, there's a lot happening digitally on looking at our processes in the organization, looking at our logistics cost, looking at our supply chain cost, and introducing a lot of digital applications in the system to try and reduce all these hidden costs. Again, that's an ongoing, which will be sustainable. As already I have mentioned to you earlier quarters also, we have very clearly identified bad costs versus good costs. We have been able to reduce our fixed costs going forward. Actually, COVID has really taught us new ways of doing business. So digital launches of our products have happened, whereby reducing our travel cost and the entire cost of launching of a product has come down to really negligible. With more reach of customers, we launched our AP plant again digitally, which is doing very good. So these are some of the costs which will stay within the organization and are sustainable. As far as price hikes are concerned, Gaurav already mentioned we had done a 3% price hike in truck. We will continue to keep on increasing prices as we go along. And we have to see, it's a very clear balance between price and market share. As you know, we are clearly the market leaders in all the radio product categories. So we'll continue to look at volume, but we are looking at very clear profitable growth. We are not going to go after just market share and keeping prices at a low point. We'll continue to increase our market share, but profitably. That is the mantra of the organization.
Okay. Any capex and revenue growth guidance for the current year?
Gaurav?
So Rahul, in the current environment, as I mentioned, the demand part is very uncertain. So difficult to give a specific guidance. We would definitely see still healthy growth, given that last year numbers were impacted and we are at a run rate of a significantly higher number. So at a bare minimum, I would say we would look at a 20% plus growth top line this year. On the capex front, the expected cash outflow for the Indian operations is about ₹1,800 crores. This is higher than the 1,600 crores that we had talked earlier. The growth capexes are all the same as we mentioned earlier, which is largely completion of the AP greenfield. However, in the current scenario, we have upped the spend on maintenance of our plants and some of the digitization initiatives and infrastructure to make sure that we are able to take advantage of the strong demand once it comes back.
Okay. Thank you and good luck for the current year.
Thank you, Rahul.
The next question is from Mr. Mayur. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
We are just going through the numbers. Wanted to understand there is a difference of gross margin between Indian operations and overall what we have reported. So your Indian operations are much lower. So are you saying that the hit of RMC is probably the highest in India at this point?
Let me try and answer that, Gaurav. See, India product mix is very different to Europe product mix. India product mix is much more heavier on natural rubber, which is at an all-time high. Our main production is on truck, even PCR, but truck constitutes to over 60-65% of our production, whereas Europe is mainly on PCR. So the raw material prices that have gone up are really hitting on not only on the truck side, but also on the agri side. And that is why you see a margin difference between Europe and India. Gaurav, would you like to add anything here?
And Mayur, this is not something which is a unique phenomenon only for this quarter. Indian operations or operations in any of the developing nations, raw materials as a percentage of sales have always been higher compared to a US or a European operations. So yes, the gross margins of our Indian operations are typically lower than the European operations.
Yeah, sure. No, so I was just, looking at that difference. That difference has probably gone up pretty significantly in this quarter. And as you mentioned that this quarter cost is only about 140 rupees of natural rubber. And currently, I believe natural rubber is hovering at that 170 rupee mark. So do we expect significant pressure coming in the Indian business? Despite, I would want to assume, if the industry takes a 4% hike this quarter, there will still be a significant hit coming on through the gross margins. Am I reading it right?
Yes, as I mentioned, even going into Q1, the raw material prices are expected to go up sequentially in high single digits. So the pressure would come. And the movement that you're talking about is also correct, because while we saw a 12% increase in raw materials in our Indian operations, there was no such increase for the European operations. And that's why the differential trend you see that you're talking about on the gross margin.
Right. And one last question. So, since you're saying that our Dutch operations are practically at full capacities, and we do believe we could do better numbers from the European arm as well. So, you expect a typical double-digit growth coming into the overall European business as well?
Again, subject to how the pandemic situation plays out, Mayur, we are looking to target a double-digit growth on the top-line front in the Europe operations.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from Mr. Jinesh Gandhi. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, sir. My question pertains to our capex and capacity. Given expectation of reasonably good growth for FY22 and demand outlook bearing the COVID situation remains strong, do we need to look at next phase of growth for India capacity as well?
No, I think, Jinesh, we have already mentioned Andhra is in its second phase of expansion. Where already capex has gone and most of it will go in this year within the amount that Gaurav has mentioned. That will be the final AP for now. And we will see how the demand picks up in various geographies. Right now, there is no growth capex that is going into the organization.
Okay, okay. And secondly, we were planning to shift some of the capacities of our Dutch plant to Hungary and India. So can you guide on by when should we expect that shifting to happen and what kind of capacities will be added to India and Hungary plant?
Gaurav, you want to answer that?
Dinesh, it's when you say shifting of capacity, that capacity already exists. There are minor debottlenecking kind of investments that are going in Hungary, which will up the capacity from 4.5 million units to 5.5 million passenger car. India, the AP ramping up. So the shifting of capacity when we talk, it's in terms of that the sourcing mix would change. So to give you a broad idea, if in FY20, the Dutch plant had produced about 3.7 million passenger car units in FY22, that would be 500,000 passenger car units. And about 3 million plus additional units get sourced from Hungary and India.
Got it, got it. So effectively, we are saying 1 million additionally from Hungary and 2 million from India. Is that understanding correct?
No, it would be even more from Hungary, because Hungary was not at its peak level in FY20, the number that I talked about. So in the current year, FY22, Hungary capacity would still be only at 4.5 million. And only towards end of FY22 and for FY23, it will start going up and be at 5.5 million.
Got it. Great. Thanks. I'll come back in queue.
Thanks, Jinesh.
The next question is from Amin Pirani. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes. Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. My first question is actually just a clarification on the European operations. So if I look at the presentation, quarter-on-quarter revenues are flattish and margins have improved significantly. But in the segmental reporting, it appears that both revenue and segment results are down. Is it because of Rifle or is there something else which is there in the segment results in the SEBI format?
Should I take the question? Yeah. So, I mean, you're right. When you look at the segmental results, because that has to regulatory-wise capture whole of Europe, it includes Rifen. Rifen has a seasonally very large swing from the December quarter, which is the winter tire season, to the next quarter. For the European manufacturing and sales operation, which is our Dutch operations, Hungary plant, and whatever is imported, that is flattish, and that is where the big margin uptick has happened on account of the salary cost particularly coming down in the January to March quarter.
Fair enough. That's helpful. Secondly, my question was more on the increasing sourcing from India for the European sales. Now, so it's a two-part question. A, how should we think of margins as you shift the sourcing? Because first, my question is, when you sell Wedestein branded tires in Europe, which are made in India, does it impact pricing, if at all? And secondly, while you have a lower cost of operations in India versus Europe, there would be the addition of freight cost, which in the case of tires can be quite significant. So how should we think of profitability going forward for the European revenues as sourcing, you know, becomes increasingly from India?
Okay, I'll take the first question. And the answer is no, it does not have any significant price reduction, not at all, whether the tires are made in India or whether they are made in Europe. The brand Fredestein itself is a premium brand in the European market. So we do not intend to reduce prices at all. Gaurav?
And I mean, we have looked at it. So by sourcing from India, even after adding the freight cost, we are not compromising on the margins. And that is where the supply chain teams becomes very critical of the allocation of production and the production optimization between plants and geographies. But fundamentally, with the ramping up of Hungary, we are in 1 to 2 years' time going to be reaching our original hypothesis that the landed cost of a product from India, after taking into account the freight and the inventory cost, is where our Hungary cost of production should be. So to that extent, we would be fairly neutral between the two, barring exchange rate issues.
Okay. So basically, you're saying that if landed cost of India is equal to Hungary cost of production, then both of them combined should definitely be better than Netherlands. So ideally, directionally, it should be margin accretive.
Yes.
Basically. Okay. Fair enough. That's helpful. I'll come back in the queue.
Thanks, Amin.
The next question is from Sonal Gupta. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon. Thanks for taking my question. Just a couple of first clarifications. One is there, I mean, the other operating income is high in this quarter as well. So is there any one-off in the other operating income?
No, Sonal, there's no one-off. There is a certain amount of investment promotion subsidy, which earlier had stopped because of this switch from VAT to GST. And there was a lack of clarity. So compared to previous quarters before Q3, the number would be higher. That number is just a little short of 40 crores. And that may be the extent to which you're feeling it's higher.
So this will continue every quarter now?
That's correct.
Okay. And just on the raw material cost side also for India, I mean, like you said, you've seen almost a 12%. But if we look at the raw material cost as a percentage, it's moved only 300 basis points quarter on quarter. So I understand, I mean, there's obviously some amount of price increase as well, which is probably offsetting 300, 400 basis points. But is there some benefit of lower cost inventory still in this quarter, or is this pretty much, at market right now?
It would be pretty much at market, because one of the other things that was happening through the year, given the strong demand, there was not a large amount of inventory that we were carrying. We were fairly tight, whether on raw material or finished goods inventory. So there would not be any significant backlog of previous quarter, just about maybe maximum a month, 3 weeks to a month.
Right. And so could you give Rifen numbers for the quarter and the year?
Just 1 minute. So Rifen for the quarter was 30 million compared to the same period last year of 26 million. For the full year, Rifen reported 180 million euros compared to a revenue of 164 million the previous year.
Right. And Rifen full year EBITDA would be?
Full year EBITDA would be 9 million.
And this last question from my side is in terms of, I mean, just understanding this a shift between Europe and India. So have you already started supplying tires from India to Europe? Is a lot of that transition already happened?
Well, it's an ongoing thing. It takes time for the molds. Molds have already in India. Already production has started. In the earlier quarter, yes, tires are going into Europe. But as we go along, ramp-ups will happen. And the major quantity will start coming in this fiscal year.
Okay, so we're not waiting for the AP capacity to come in for this to ramp up?
No, this is happening within AP, within Baroda, within Chennai. So it's all over allocated.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
To answer your question, it does not have any hindrance on export because of Andhra. Okay, thank you.
The next question is from Mansi Suman. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, good afternoon, sir. Thank you for taking my question. So my first question is, could you provide us the segment-wise capacities for the truck and bus segment, passenger cars, and the LCV and other segment, and also provide international capacities?
Gaurav?
Yeah. So Mansi, our capacity on the truck bus bias is about 450 metric tons. On the truck radial side, once AP ramps up fully, we will be a little short of 800 metric ton or about 14,500 tires per day. On passenger car side, it's in excess of 300 metric tons per day, or in number of tires in excess of 50,000 tires per day in India.
Sir, and the LCV and the other segment?
I won't have the numbers overall, but our total capacity now, once AP ramps up, would be about 2,000 metric tons per day.
Okay, and so the international capacities?
On the international side, Hungary in 2 years' time would be at 5.5 million passenger car tires per annum, which is, I think, about 17,000 odd tires per day. And if you add the Dutch plant PCR capacity of 0.5 million, our total European capacity would be 6 million tires per day. On the truck radial side, we are currently at a small capacity in Hungary of 450,000 tires per annum.
Okay. So, and one additional question. So, in Andhra Pradesh, what is the additional capacity that is coming in, and when should we expect it to come?
We will reach the planned capacities by the end of this fiscal year, so by March 22, where we will get to 15,000 passenger car tires per day and 3,000 TBR per day. That number is changing every month. So it would not really have any relevance whether I give you a March number or an April number.
Okay. Okay. Thank
you. Thank you.
The next question is from Kaushik Podar. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah. With the prices of commodity being so volatile, what is the steady state margin we can think about?
Kaushik, we really do not want to comment on a margin guidance, which we have never. At the end of the day, we can give you a steady state or a normalized margin if one gives us a steady state raw material basket price. It's a dynamic situation. It's our largest cost element and has to be managed through intelligent sourcing, the work that R&D does that Neeraj talked about, which is working on recipes, price increases. So we really can't give you a steady state margin.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from Mr. Jitendra Khatri. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes, sir, I wanted to ask you, in your European subsidiary, so the employee cost to sales, would that be pretty much in line with how the other tire makers are operating out there, or there is some substantial scope for cost savings?
Tire benefit of the specialization of the Enschede plant is still not coming, but Okay. Now in quarter one, you will see the cost as a percentage to sale further coming down from where it is. And that will be in very much in line with the international players who are playing in Europe.
Okay. So what will be the scope of that saving? So let's say right now, if the number is around 25%,
it should come below 20%. Once at a steady state, it should be below 20%.
Okay. And sir, and when we talk about the capacities, often an interchangeable term is used, tires per day, metric tons per day. Is there a standard conversion between the two that you use or which you can communicate to us, be it for TBR, TBB or PCR?
Gaurav?
Jiten, there is no standard conversion rate because the product weights are very different, and it's also not as if the capacities are fungible from one category to the other.
Okay.
So the overall capacity, while on bias side, there is some amount of interchangeability possible.
Okay.
So a metric ton per day would be a relevant figure. But if you talk of TBR capacity or passenger car capacity, you would always be better off taking the numbers per day or the numbers per annum.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks, Gaurav. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
The next question is from Disha Sheth. Your line is on. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello. Yeah. Congratulations on good set of numbers. Wanted to ask, how much market share have we gained in the different categories in FY21? That would be my first question. In India.
Gaurav, you want to take that?
Yeah. So, Disha, as per our estimates, in passenger car and agri, we have gained almost close to 400 basis points on market share.
So, that would stand at how much? Like, after 400 basis points, we stand at how much market share?
We should be at around 21%. And on the truck side, we would be overall at about 30%. We believe we have gained about close to 100 basis points market share.
And so if we see the maths, if raw material have gone up by 12% and we have taken approximately 4% increase in pricing, so the 8%, then how where are we saving if raw material has gone up by 12%? We have taken only 4% price increase. Margins are down only by 3% quarter on quarter.
So the 1 odd percent Disha, that you're talking about, and the number may be slightly lower if we go into exact decimals. That's the saving on the fixed costs that Neeraj talked about, which is continuously focusing on the good cost but eliminating the bad costs. We have talked about the digital initiatives. We have talked about digital product launches, digital conferences, etc., and a whole lot of other costs that we have looked to control through the year.
And just a follow-up question. You said the consolidated debt stands at 40 million, right?
43. Net debt,
43. Net. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from Mr. Basudev Banerjee. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, thanks, Himanshu. Congrats, sir, for a good set of numbers. A few questions. At current level, what will be the annual sustainable maintenance capex for India and for Europe separately?
So, Basudev, the annual maintenance capex for India should be about 200 to 250 crores. Why I give you a range of 50 crores, that in some of the years, if a mixer maintenance comes up, the number may go up. For Europe, that number would be in the region of 20 million euro.
Sure. Second question, sir. On a sequential basis in India, if you can comment on truck replacement market volume change for Apollo as such.
On a sequential basis, Basudev?
Truck replacement, yes.
Just a minute. So for replacement, on a sequential basis, in fact, truck was down by about 5%.
Okay. More or less commensurate with another peer who gave commentary on that. Third thing, sir, in your annual numbers balance sheet, if I see inventory and receivables, the movement, but in current liability, the movement has been much sharper, which is resulting in bulk of working capital reduction. So any year-end phenomena because of COVID payables got delayed or which will be taken care in coming quarter? How to look at that, sir?
While we can look at the details, but there have been no delay in payables. Both our operations are sitting on a fairly healthy balance sheet and excess cash. So we've not delayed out any payables, Basudev. But to your specific query, we'll have to look at it in detail and come back to you.
Sure. And last question, sir. As you mentioned, down the line, Hungary will be 5.5 million PCR per annum, and Dutch will be 0.5. So the Dutch, from where it has been reduced to 0.5 as such?
So the Dutch plant, as I mentioned in FY20, Basudev, produced 3.7 million units of passenger car.
So that has been restructured to 0.5.
Yeah, as of now, when we say restructured or specialized, it's only around the people.
Mm-hmm.
We have equipment. As and when, if we look to expand capacity, if there are some equipment which are in good condition and can be used, we will do that.
So to look at Europe operation as whole, Dutch operating almost at full?
Yes. Currently, based on the specialization of the plant, the Dutch plant is operating at full capacity almost.
And Hungary producing roughly, as you said, 4.5.
Yeah. To clarify, the 4.5 million that we are targeting in the current year will also almost be a full capacity of Hungary, because the debottlenecking of Hungary capacity will start this year. So the capacity ramping up will only start happening in the second half. And only in FY23 will the Hungary plant have the capacity of 5.5 million.
And this debottlenecking will cost you how much, sir?
This will cost us somewhere in the range of 10 to 15 million euro. Some of that capex is being incurred as we speak.
Sure. So roughly, one can assume that post debottlenecking of Hungary, and when the utilization reaches at higher levels in Hungary, the next level of expansion in Europe can be through further recalibrating the production in Dutch plant.
We will take a call on that, Basudev. A, with 5.5 million of Hungary and with the production optimization along with India plants, we are good for at least a couple of years. So at this stage, what is further needed is something, a call that will be taken down the line based on how the product mix evolves.
Sure, sir. That's great. Thanks.
Thank you.
The next question is from Mr. Nishit Dalan. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, sir. Thank you for giving me an opportunity again. Two questions from my side. Firstly, you mentioned that in Europe, the landed cost of tires from India is almost equal to that of Hungary. So then is it fair to assume that in future, there is no point doing capacity expansion in Europe, because obviously capex per ton in Europe will be higher than in India. And in terms of profitability, it's equal. So ideally, it makes sense to expand capacities in India whenever needed. That's the first question.
So Nishit, it's also not a static phenomenon. As I said, it also plays into exchange rate and the freight costs. It's an evaluation that would be done continuously. And also take into account that at a certain point, dependence on export or import, whichever way you look at it, beyond a certain point starts becoming a risk in itself. But fundamentally, yes, and that position will be reached down the line. It's not the case today, but as Hungary ramps up, if that condition remains, yes, we are neutral between expanding capacity in India or Europe. And to your point, yes, the return on that investment would also be taken into account as to where that capex should be incurred.
Okay, thank you. My second question is more on India business, slightly longer term. If I looked at in the last 7 to 8 years, the ASP per kg for the company has been kind of flattish, which means there has hardly been any inflation in the tires, while obviously in India, we have seen inflation everywhere. And if I combine this with the fact that the ROC profile of tire industry is generally quite low, that's true for everybody in the sector, not only for Apollo. So then how should we look at it? Why as an industry, we are not able to increase tire prices to improve ROC ROC of the business? That's a more of an industry-driven question, but obviously you being market leaders in a couple of important segments now, I wanted to get your thoughts, right? Because some bit of an inflation is definitely possible in every commodity, which we have not seen in tires. So sir, your thoughts on this would be useful. Thank you.
Yeah, I think from my side, I like to say today, if I see the past 15 to 10 years trend in pricing, the Indian industry has matured from what we were and to now where we are. Even if you see our ROCEs have improved over time. Okay. But obviously, yes, we cannot compare ourselves to auto components or to the OEMs in the auto segment. It is a very, I would say, a labor intensive industry, very, very dependent on commodity prices, oil prices. And there is a very clear balance on volume and price gain. And given the heavy competition and the in India, up until recently, you know, China was exporting tires into India in huge amounts. Only last year, the government came up with a restriction list. So you have seen prices of passenger car tires going up and significantly up, and therefore you're seeing margin improvements happening. So it's really the industry is maturing, and slowly, slowly, as we are the leaders in the industry, both in volume and in pricing, we have to always take the lead. And there is always a lag effect of competition coming and supporting us in this difficult times. Gaurav, you want to add anything here?
The only other point is, Nishit, that one of the other factors for this industry has been with the shift from bias to radial, the capital intensity has gone up. And what you are seeing is is over the last 5-7 years that you mentioned, a significant increase in capital intensity, which has impacted the ROCEs. And as the whole thing becomes more and more radial, the industry would start also pricing and giving returns commensurate to the previous time before the 7-year period.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from Mr. Shashank Kanodia. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. So just wanted to ask now, since we have quite a substantial cash balance, so how will we have brought this trajectory going forward?
Shashank, I couldn't get your question. Substantial so, cash balance?
Yeah, so sir, how will be a gross debt trajectory going forward, right? So we normally used to hold less than 1,000 crores of cash balance, but now it's in excess of 2,000 odd crores. So when do we see, you know, gross debt repayments for us kicking in?
So Shashank, we have scheduled debt repayments over the next 3 odd years of 500, 600 crores each year in India, and a certain amount of 15 to 20 million in Europe. The current year, the capex in India is still a substantial amount. So we may not see a further gross debt reduction in the current year. But going forward, as the operation is growing, that number would again come down further.
Right. So the gross debt figure on consolidated basis would be roughly 6,500 odd crores as of financial year ending?
Just 1 minute. Yes, it is 6,400 crores.
Right. And so secondly, you know, Mr. Kanwar alluded to, you know, returning to the double-digit return issues trajectory sometime later during the course of time. So, sir, any tangible timeline that you like to put, or any 15% kind of range that we can achieve in the next 2 years or 3 years?
So, Shashank, if we take out the Q1 quarter, which was a washout for any player or any industry, both for India operations and for consolidated operations, if we just annualize the 9-month results, so not just the last quarter, our ROCEs would already be in double digits. So we are already moving towards that goal. It is something that we understand is a parameter, financial benchmark on which we were not at the right levels. And we are focused on delivering that on a consistent basis.
Right. And sir, one last thing. Sir, any one-offs in the standalone employee cost? Or is it a sustainable run rate going forward?
This is a sustainable level. As AP ramps up, there may be some increases in manpower cost, but nothing substantial.
Sure. Thank you so much, sir. Wish you all the best.
Thank you.
The next question is from Shaleen Seth. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, good afternoon, gentlemen. Congratulations on these great numbers. I just have a quick question on the expansion in your in the rural Indian side. I see that you guys have reached to 5,800 outlets and sub-dealers. So what exactly are we looking? Why are we so aggressive in the rural side suddenly? And the second question would be, what is the cost implication of this?
This is our drive to get into new areas of distribution. And as you know, India today is banking a lot on rural segment. This is not a new initiative. It's been there for the past 3 years. Only we've gone a bit more aggressive since we have launched our two-wheeler category range. As you know, two-wheeler is very important in the rural market. Given that we are very strong in agri, given that we are very strong in truck buyers, the entire composite of the entire product portfolio is beneficial, very beneficial in the rural market. I wouldn't say there's any additional cost. There's a normal cost of adding distribution to the network, but there's no additional cost of adding rural distribution in the company. But this is also one of the key areas which has given growth to Apollo and gained market share in the Indian market.
Okay. That'll be it from myself. Thank you.
The next question is from Mr. Paras. Please unmute yourself and ask your question. Mr. Paras, you can your line is in talk mode. Please unmute yourself and ask your question. The next question is from Mr. Vasudev Banerjee. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, a few questions missed out. One, sequentially, Gaurav, can you say how much has the change been in your euro-rupee realization?
Euro-rupee realization meaning?
Transition.
Ravi, do we have the exchange rate movement?
I'll just look for it, Gaurav.
And second thing is with fleet owners' business being not in a great shape for an extended period. So how is the radialization in replacement market happening as per your field channel checks?
Gaurav?
So Basudev, with the restriction on imports, overall, we saw the a fairly good resurgence of buyers. So on your radialization in the replacement market, it's not reversed, but maybe the growth trajectory slowed down a little in this year. It is still around the 50% mark on the replacement sector.
So right way to infer will be that the rising radialization in replacement as of now has steadied rather than moving up.
It still moved up a few percentage points, but the increase has slowed down a bit.
Sure. And last question. At what utilization level you are presently operating in your TBR before Andhra Phase 2 comes in?
Just a minute. For last quarter, for example, we were operating at about 90% on the TBR front.
And what is the existing, including Andhra Phase 1?
Andhra Phase 1, Basudev, through FY21 was a constantly changing figure. So whatever was the capacity available, we would be at about 90%.
And closing FY21 in TPT terms will be how much, TBR?
We have Chennai just short of 12,000 at about 11,500 truck radials a day. And Andhra was, I think, at about 1,000 radials a day.
And in TPD terms?